Hey, what is up, guys? This is Nishi here, back with another Market Watch episode. So now that Burst of Destiny has officially been released for a little bit now, we can start to see how it is affecting the meta. Sword Soul is, as we all expected, an amazing deck and is definitely living up to its hype. But the Fluwanderies are an interesting strategy as well that have some interesting potential. There's the Liralusk deck that's relatively new, and then there's still all of the other existing decks that now have to adapt to the current format. So today we're going to go over some cards that are trending on the market because of their relevance to the meta. Let's get started. Okay, so we're going to kick things off with a card that we've talked about a little bit before. We have Ruddy Rose Dragon. So this is a generic level 10 synchro monster that's currently seeing play in the Sword Soul extra deck with a pretty straightforward effect. On summon, it banishes all cards from both players' graveyards. The other effect isn't too relevant unless you're trying to play a pure Black Rose deck, but the first effect can be really devastating when it resolves. There are certain decks that need access to cards in their graveyard in order to play, such as Sky Strikers and Eldritch, so going into Ruddy Rose Dragon can make it nearly impossible for them to function. I remember early on, this card was about $10 to $15. We saw it go up to $20 when people first started talking about it being used in the Sword Soul deck. Now, however, the card is all the way up at $30 a piece, as it has proven itself to be a very potent threat in the current format that all Sword Soul players need to have access to. Now, this card obviously has just the one printing, as it came out fairly recently in Lightning Overdrive and shouldn't be reprinted until the 2022 Megatins. I would expect the card to maintain its current price point for a while, since it'll be sought after, but it is still something that's only needed at one. If a lot of other decks were to get hit and Sword Soul were to become the best deck of the format, then I could see it bumping up a bit more with an increase in demand, but more than likely I'm expecting this card to stay within the $25 to $30 range. Now, while we're looking at the Sword Soul cards, Tenyi Sword Soul is an extremely popular variant of the strategy, making use of cards from the Tenyi archetype. The engine is really cool, as you can special summon them when you have no effect monsters on the field, so they allow you to get bodies out early without burning your normal summon, and they also have graveyard effects as well. They're also worms that can be used for the effects of cards like Moyi, Qi Xiao, and Long Yuan. Now, Ashuna is an important one because while it's in your graveyard, you can banish it to special summon another Tenyi monster directly out of your deck, which could be Vishuda or Edhara, at the cost of locking you into worms for the rest of the turn. If you are playing the Tenyi package, it's definitely something that you'll want to have access to, and I believe that Ashuna is the one that they play at 3, though obviously you're not going to be playing it if you're running the pure version of the strategy. Now, unlike Edhara and Vishuda, Ashuna was never reprinted in an OTS tournament pack, so there's only the original rare printing, which is currently $4 to $5 right now, and then the common printing from last year's Megatins, which are $2 to $3 each. It was definitely something that a lot of people were overlooking in their bulk last year, so if you do have last year's Megatin bulk sitting around somewhere, it just might be worth setting that aside, digging into it, and setting aside any copies of Ashuna, Vishuda, and Edhara that you're able to find. Alright, next we're going to take a look at a couple of cards that are popular because of the Fluwanderies strategy, and we're starting off with Dimension Shifter. We did talk about this card a couple of weeks ago when it was around $4 to $5. Dimension Shifter is a popular hand trap in the strategy because they don't really make use of their graveyard, so they can hurt other decks without hurting themselves. It's also worth mentioning that over in the OCG, there are some Sword Soul decks that are using Dimension Shifter to counter decks like Phantom Knights, who can then go into Ruddy Rose Dragon and be able to resolve Dimension Shifter in the mid game as well. Anyways, Fluwanderies is actually a really cheap deck to put together here. The only secret rare that you need from Burst of Destiny is Empin, and then Mega Ryza is a few bucks as well, but other than that, the strategy is fairly affordable, so with a lot of people looking for Dimension Shifter, it's only natural that the price is going to go up, to where you're now looking at having to pay $8 per copy. Obviously, we have to take this with a grain of salt because it seems more and more likely by the day that Dimension Shifter will be reprinted. Dark Ruler No More and Nibiru have already seen reprints, so it makes sense that Dimension Shifter should see a reprint sometime soon, given its surge in popularity. I would definitely be okay with holding onto a set if you're wanting to play the Fluwanderies deck, but make sure that you move any additional copies that you happen to be holding onto while the price is relatively high before the card gets reprinted. Next, let's take a brief look at Mist Valley Apex Avion. So I feel like this is a card that has seen play in several different decks since like 2015 or so, because it provides that really free negate. But yeah, Apex Avion is a straightforward card. You bounce a Mist Valley card, in this case, or in most cases, Apex Avion, back to your hand from the field to negate the activation of an opponent's card. There are two places that this card is used in within today's meta. The first and the most common is as an alternative boss monster in the Flow Wanderer's strategy, since you can tribute summon this card fairly easily, and it's a good alternative to Empin or Mega Ryza. The second way is in certain Tri Brigade variants, where you can go into the Simorgh Link monster and summon Apex Avion directly out of your deck as a free negate during your first turn, though this is a bit more niche and not as common. So this card does have three printings available. The original DT printing is of course the most expensive, currently at $35, and the secret rares are also up there once again at $25 each. However, it is worth noting that even the Shadows in Valhalla super rares, which were under 50 cents before, are also up now at $3 each, which is kind of crazy to me. I think it really speaks to how many people are looking to build the Flow Wanderer's as a more budget-friendly, newer meta alternative, since Apex Avion is definitely a card you will want to run in the deck. Do keep in mind though that this card is typically just a one of, so it might be something that's worth offloading your extra copies of. Okay, so this is an interesting one that I've seen popping up a little bit recently. It's Forbidden Chalice. So in my mind, Chalice is kind of like an alternative to Infinite Impermanence and Forbidden Droplet, providing quick play monster effect negation during your own turn, or also functioning as back row disruption. It is a bit different from either of those two cards. Infinite Impermanence requires you to have no cards in order to play it from your hand, so if you've committed something to the field already, you can't play Impermanence, but you could still Chalice your opponent's monster. It also doesn't need you to send anything to the graveyard, right? Unlike Droplet, so Chalice would actually be a good alternative to Droplet in a deck like Flow Wanderer's, since the Flow Wanderer's monsters banish themselves and Droplet doesn't work there. It's not the most revolutionary or game-breaking card, but it is still a cool alternative that has its own niche uses. Anyways, the card is now seeing its price trend upwards all across the board, with Ultimate Rares bought out and being $200 each, and then the original Ultras being $50 or something crazy like that on TCG Player as well. The interesting thing is that the card has received a ton of low rarity printings, and those versions are all still trending up. The gold rares are $4 to $5 now, and all of the other common versions are actually like a dollar each or something like that, which is odd given that it has basically been reprinted into the ground. I think you should definitely make sure that you own a set of this card, though probably just the common since you don't need to buy the ultis right now. Anyways, also make note of how high the prices of those original printings are, and see if you can offload them if you have them while they're seeing some meta hype. Alright, another fairly random one here, but Artifact Sanctum is a card that is starting to pop up in side decks once again. Sanctum is a really simple card, special summoning an artifact out of your deck. In today's game, you are probably special summoning Scythe to lock your opponent out of the extra deck, so that you can OTK them on the following turn. So Scythe is still a really strong card, but it has seen even more play recently with the release of Destroy Phoenix Enforcer, as people use the new Destiny hero to pop a Scythe that is set to your back row. Sanctum is just another way to access Scythe, perhaps in matchups where you've sided out the Destiny Hero package, but still want to be able to use Scythe. It's also worth noting that if your opponent tries to pop your Sanctum with something like Destroy Phoenix Enforcer, that would trigger Sanctum's other effect and allow you to pop one of your opponent's cards for free. Anyways, Sanctum is a card that has a history of being fairly expensive. Now, though, the card has received multiple printings that have managed to keep its price down to a relatively affordable level, though we are starting to see them creep up once again. The Secret Rare reprint from one of the Battles of Legends set, which is the highest rarity, is now $8, and then all three of the Ultra Rare printings, including the original, are around $5 each. Personally, I really like the way the secrets look, though of course the ultras are the slightly more affordable alternative. This card has a history of popping in and out of the meta every now and then, but every time it shows up, a lot of people pick it up because it's a straightforward package that's easy to use, yet it's really strong and can help you win games on its own. If you don't own the card already, it's probably worth looking at picking up a set for yourself to use so that you have them available. After being reprinted in the last two Battles of Legends sets, it should be fairly easy to find. However, this is a card that will slowly get eaten up off of the market, and based on how the card's price has behaved in the past, it certainly could hit that $8 to $10 mark for all versions of the card sometime in the near future, assuming that the card doesn't see another reprint. Okay guys, one last card I want to take a look at for today is Tri Brigade Shurag the Ominous Omen. So I'm sure you guys all know what this card is by now. It is the Link 4 that is generally played at 2 in decks using the Tri Brigade engine. It allows you to banish a card on summon, so you generally summon it off of Revolt to disrupt your opponent. It also has an effect that lets you add a Beast Family monster from your deck to your hand when it's sent to the graveyard, whose level is less than or equal to your number of banished Beast Family monsters. So I'm looking at this card as something that might be worth picking up a few extra copies of now because it's still fairly affordable. The original secret rares are only around $10 right now, while the reprints from the Megatins are only $2 to $3. I think that this card might be a useful card in the extra deck for Flawanda Reese decks using the Dogmatica package, since it's a 3000 attack point body that you can dump off of Punishment to pop an opponent's monster, and then use Shureg's effect to search for a Winged Beast monster from your deck for free as well. I don't know how many people are on the Dogmatica engine in Flawanda Reese right now, especially since it doesn't seem to be as popular as something like Sword Soul, but with Flawanda Reese getting a really good quick play spell card in the upcoming set Battle of Chaos, as well as a new ban list being right around the corner, the Flawanda Reese could be an extremely scary meta deck, and Shureg might potentially be an important extra deck card for a deck that doesn't really summon from the extra deck at all. I'm not saying that this is a card to go out and buy like 100 copies of, right? But it's definitely a cheap card that's worth picking up here and there to round off trades if you can find them. Alright guys, that is it for today's episode. This format is actually looking really interesting, a lot of big changes coming with the release of Burst of Destiny here in the TCG. Do keep in mind that we also have a new ban list coming right around the corner, probably just in time for YCS Pasadena. The best decks of the format are always going to be one of the biggest factors affecting the Yu-Gi-Oh! Market and card prices, so be sure to try and keep track of what decks are performing especially well and whatnot, so that you guys can try to figure out what's going to happen with the market as well. Anyways guys, if you did enjoy today's Market Watch episode, make sure that you hit that thumbs up button for me to let me know. Also make sure you leave a comment in the comment section below. Let me know what you guys think about today's cards and what other cards are trending on the market as well, so we can cover those in a future episode. Also, if you haven't already, make sure you hit that subscribe button to get all of the latest and greatest content from both me and Tombox. And until next time guys, don't forget to hold on to your MST.TV.